Good morning. Welcome to Riviera Presbyterian Church. We're so glad that you're with us this morning. Today we celebrate the life of Martin Luther King and his mission. So it is fitting that we sing an opening song, number 301, Let Us Build a House Where All Are Welcome. We'll sing the first two verses of 301. Please join with us.
Good morning. My name is Missy Shiverick, and I'm the pastor at Riviera Presbyterian Church. Riviera is a progressive congregation whose fundamental belief is that all are God's beloved children and that there are absolutely no exceptions to that. If you are a visitor with us this morning, welcome. I have to say that in this time of unrest where violence has been people have called for violence to be erupting all over our country in the state capitals, and the government buildings. There is not a more important place to be than to be worshiping, to be together as a community, and to reaffirm that God is with us and that God is in control. We worship online due to the COVID pandemic, and because we care and love you and love ourselves, and we are looking forward to the day when we can be together and can greet everyone in person. But until then, welcome, and if you would scroll down on your worship bulletin online, you will find a place to sign in, to tell us a little bit about yourself, and to put down any prayer requests that you have for this morning. I also would love to invite you to please join us after worship during our Zoom coffee hour, which we call Holy Grounds. And because I think now, today, it's an important time to be together. And we are a community of love. Let us worship God.
Call to worship. Lord, where shall we find the courage to envisage a new beginning?
Out of the depths, created God, we come to you.
In our confusion, we cry to you, and suddenly comes exciting news.
You who abide in heaven and heavenly realms, you have come to us.
You have not considered the smallness of our planet or the ephemeral nature of our lives.
It is grace, pure, unlimited grace.
Our human predicament, you have made yours.
And now you announce a new morning, a new beginning.
And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God.
See, I am making all things new.
Call to confession. Too often our hearts are cold and without gratitude. Too often our hands are passive and unwilling to carry out acts of mercy. Too often our lips are pursed tightly and unwilling to carry out acts of love. Too often we are separated and alienated from our better selves, separated and alienated from God. Let us confess our separation and alienation. Let us join together in the prayer of confession. O God, we bear the imprint of your face. The colors of our skin are your design, and what we have of beauty in our race as human beings, you alone define. You created us and stretched a living fabric on our frame and gave to each a language and a name. Where we are torn and pulled apart by hate because of our race, or that our skin is not the same, and when we are judged unequal by others, you are dishonored, O God, and we are reduced to little worth. All too often we are blind by our complicity in the maintenance of systems of oppression. Give us the courage to name our sin. Give us the strength to claim our responsibility for our actions. Give us the grace to pay the price for changing our behavior. Through Jesus Christ we pray, amen. The assurance of pardon. God says to us, you are my chosen ones. I love you. I am proud of you. Stand firm in your renewed commitment. Know that I have forgiven you. I will call you by name. You are mine. I have entered into covenant with you and will stand by you in all times and all places. Dare to live fully the life to which I have called you. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and restored to new life.
Good morning, my friends, and welcome to today's children's sermon. Today, I want to talk to you about being scared. This season, this past year, all of 2020 almost, and already the beginning of 2021, we've been scared. We've been scared about maybe getting COVID. We've been scared about our loved ones, our moms, our grandpas getting COVID. That's a lot. It's been a lot. And it's perfectly normal to be scared. The adults are scared. The teenagers are scared. The kiddos, you guys are probably scared. It's a lot. But here's the cool thing about being a Christian. One of my favorite things about being a Christian is that when we're scared, we can talk to God. We can tell God how we feel, and God understands and loves it. But here's the thing. God also already knows that we're scared. God already knows how we feel, so we don't even need to ask God. So one of my favorite parts of the service is the benediction. Can you say benediction? Benediction. And it's basically the end of the service where Missy raises her hands. And it's God's gift to you. It's words that God says that are a gift to you. So one of my favorite benedictions is probably from Ireland from a very, 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 very long time ago. And I've actually said it a couple of times at Riviera. And I just want to read it to you quick and then we're going to talk about it. So the benediction, the gift to you, says this. God go before you to lead you. God go behind you to protect you. God go beneath you to support you. God go beside you to befriend you. Do not be afraid. May the blessing of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you. Do not be afraid. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. So even though I say those words, even though Missy might say those words are directly from God and they're talking to you, my friends. They are talking to you. God is saying that God is with you, that God is behind you to protect you, that God is beneath you to support you. And more importantly, my friends of all ages, God is telling us not to be afraid. Do not be afraid. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Do not be afraid. And I don't know about you, but when the Lord, the God of the universe, who created you so beautiful and perfect, when the God of the universe, who created zebras and oceans so deep that we can't reach, I listen. I listen when God says, do not be afraid. So my friends, I want you to remember as this week continues, as these months keep on going, remember, do not be afraid. Because God is with you and God is giving you gifts of hope, of courage, and of knowing that you belong to God. I hope you have a wonderful rest of your week. I'll see you at the Zoom call and at the Narnia reading. Talk to you later. Bye.
Now that we've heard the children's time, we have time to think about it and sing the hymn number 20, All Things Bright and Beautiful. We'll sing one verse of number 20.
Prayer of illumination. Shine upon us, God of glory, and by your Spirit reveal to us the grace and truth about Jesus Christ, your Word made flesh. Amen.
We shall.
This reading is from James the second, verses 14 to 26. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith, but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I by my works will show you my faith. You believe in God as one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, you, a senseless person, that faith apart from works is barren? Was not our ancestor Abraham justified by works when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was brought to completion by the works. Thus, the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God and it was reckoned to him as fulfillment to him as righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. You see that a person justified by works and not by faith alone, likewise was not Rahab the prostitute also justified by works when she welcomed the messengers and sent them out by another road? For just as a body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is also dead.
Thanks be to God.
I don't need to tell you that the moment in which we are now living is historically very important. What we are now living will be studied in history books in the years that follow. Number one, we're living through a pandemic. Number two, we are living through violence and a crisis in our country's democracy. And number three, we are living through a time in which women have claimed more power in our country than ever before. And number four, we're living in a wake-up call for racial justice through the Black Lives Matter movement around the world. And although extremely anxiety-producing time in history, it's also a time when change is occurring. The world will never be the same. We will never be the same. We have experienced more and learned more and have had to be more creative this year than we ever have in our lives. And we have found ways to cope. We walk. We breathe, we pray, we're creating music and art, and we're Zooming with loved ones. And we have found again what is important, our loved ones, our community called the church, and the small wonders in God's creation. We might have been too busy to focus on all these before. And thank God, the vaccines are now coming out, and some of you have been able to be vaccinated, and the rest of us can see the light at the end of the tunnel. But it is also a time of tears and fear, A week and a half ago, our nation's capital was attacked by what can only be described as terrorists. They looted and damaged what we held as a precious symbol in our country, and they were violent, and the outcome was that people died and President Trump was impeached for the second time. And as we prepare for the transition of power this week, we fear more violence, knowing that it has been called for today and throughout this week. Our prayers are for peace and for civility to return to our great nation. And this dramatic, and in this dramatic backdrop, we celebrate the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s day, a day when we recognize the leadership and the work of Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement. He, like this year in history, changed the world. We will never be the same because of his courageous leadership in working for a world where all people are equal. Which brings me today and what the legacy of Martin Luther King Jr. is and our Black Lives Matter world. History will be able to point out events that spurred this movement in our country. And although the Black Lives Matter movement began in 2012 when George Zimmerman was acquitted in the killing of Trayvon Martin, an unarmed black teen, it erupted in protests and marches early this past summer when George Floyd, after being pinned down for 8 minutes and 46 seconds, and in his horrible death that was videoed, showed him suffocating. And we heard his last words, "I can't breathe." The violent treatment of black people by the police and the not-so-hidden racism in our country finally could not be ignored. It festered, and it made us realize perhaps our country has not moved away from the racism that caused the civil rights movement, in spite of us thinking that it had. Many of you know that the Presbytery has Zoom chats on Tuesdays for clergy and other church leaders. This past Tuesday, we talked about the violent storming of the Capitol building by the terrorists, and we processed it as people of faith personally and what they were doing with their congregations. And as sometimes happens, a pretty good esoteric theological discussion began until one pastor, the Reverend Denise McLeod, from a historically black congregation in Key West, said that it represented for her and her congregation just how unsafe black people are in our country and how racist our society is. She asked us to think what the day would have been like if it had been a Black Lives Matter protest that stormed the Capitol. Those who were protesting would have been all incarcerated and many would have been gunned down. She said for her congregation, that was a reminder of the inequality, the injustice, and the racism in which people of color must live today, each day, every moment. It was a wake-up call. It was a call for people of faith who believe in a God of justice and righteousness that has taught us to see God in each other. And we who live with the privilege of our skin color must try and understand that what we saw as horror a week and a half ago, our siblings of color saw with greater horror and absolute fear. And it's in this backdrop of our world today that we hear the words found in the Epistle of James, where he says that faith without action is meaningless. James criticizes the person of faith that says a nice phrase, wishes a person a good day or good health, while ignoring their physical needs. Just like the argument posed by people who criticize religion, Just don't tell someone you're going to pray for them. Do something for them. Faith and works. Which is most important has been an argument since Christianity began. James is quite critical of the person who claims faith, but then does not act on it. He asks if faith can even exist without works. And to James, acting on one's faith is critical and should be done even if it causes the person embarrassment or it disrupts your life. So one must ask, in this pregnant moment in history, where there's a call for violence across our country and in our nation's capital, within a pandemic, and within the painful festering of our society, what does the faithful person do? Inaction would be to side with what is against the ethic and the principles of our faith based on the teachings of Christ. Allowing racist comments or misogynistic comments to go unchecked, not pointing to the sin of violence erupting across our country and voicing the hard truths that must be said, frankly, is not living a faithful life. But voicing our opinions, pointing to the wrongs, might make us seem a little radical. However, we have to remember, Jesus was radical, and Jesus preached a radical message. We need to face that hatred festering in our society straight on and name it for what it is. That is what God calls us to do on this day in history, on this week, in the life of our nation, and as a people of faith in a God who promotes justice, who promotes love, who promotes equality, and who promotes and calls us to make shalom. Amen.
Prayers of the People in the Lord's Prayer. For an end to discrimination in all of its forms, we pray,
Lord of all nations,
hear our prayer. That each person may be respected and valued as a child of God, we pray.
Lord of all nations, hear our prayer.
That the church may be witness and a universal sign of unity among all peoples, we pray.
Lord of all nations, hear our prayer.
That each of us may acknowledge our part in mistakes and sins of the past pertaining to discrimination and racism, we pray.
Lord of all nations, hear our prayer.
For a spirit of forgiveness and reconciliation among peoples who share a history of mutual mistrust, hatred, or aggression, we pray.
Lord of all nations, hear our prayer.
That the victims of racial prejudice may forgive those who persecute them, and that their persecutors may have a change of heart, we pray.
Lord of all nations, hear our prayer. That the church will continue to strive to make every element of human life correspond to the true dignity of the human person, we pray.
Lord of all nations, hear our prayer.
That we may work to influence the attitudes of others by expressly rejecting racial or ethnic stereotypes, slurs, and jokes, and be affirming of cultural contributions of every racial and ethnic and religious group in our world, we pray.
Lord of all nations, hear our prayer.
That we may make a personal commitment to abolish social structures which inhibit economic, educational, and social advancement of the poor, we pray.
Lord of all nations, hear our prayer.
That we may work for decent working conditions, adequate income, housing, education, and health care for all people, we pray this in Christ's name, who taught us to pray in this manner.
Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
I have a few announcements to make this Sunday. The first one is the call for the annual congregational meeting, which will take place on Sunday, January 31st. And the purpose of the meeting is threefold. It is to receive the annual report, which is written every year, and this is the annual report for 2020, to receive the budget for the year 2021, and to vote on the terms of call for the pastor, for me. It will happen in a Zoom meeting following worship that day, and I hope you all will be a part of it. And then we'll go right into our Holy Grounds coffee hour. The next week, which is February 7th, we will be ending finishing the celebration of the 75th anniversary of our church. And to do so, I hope you will invite your friends and members that have moved out of town who can participate in it, because it is online. And after worship, we will have communion. And then we will have a Zoom meeting just to celebrate and celebrate what the future is in store for us. It is communion, so the day before you will be receiving a loaf of bread if you have requested it. And you also, in that package, will be a lot of things for Lent, which starts 2 weeks later. But there also will be a package of soup. And that's because our church participates in what is called Super Bowl Sunday, which is a fundraiser that was started by our national church for congregations to raise money for hunger issues. And normally we have a luncheon after church where soup is served and people donate money to hunger causes. Instead, we're giving you a soup package and asking you to donate to the church for our hunger ministries. Super Bowl Sunday was a much loved program by our now saint, Henry Barrows, who used to love to do it. Henry loved to do it with the youth of the church. And so as we participate, we also are continuing a legacy of the ministry of Elder Henry Barrow. I also want to just raise up one more thing, and that is, it was mentioned last week, but we do have a really good Christian education program starting on January 27th, which is Wednesday evenings, and it'll be the last Wednesday of each month. I've signed up for it, and I hope you will too. I am standing, as I do most Sundays, in front of our food pantry. It is a ministry that is in much demand during this COVID time, when people have lost their jobs and many are food insecure. So if you are food insecure, please come. The groceries are here for you. We are open Monday and Wednesday mornings to give out groceries. And if you have resources, please donate to our food pantry. It is now time to call for the morning offering. If you are just visiting but you have a home church, please donate to your home church. But if you are visiting and do not have a church or are a part of the Riviera community, it is now time to contemplate your tithes, your gifts, and your offerings. Let us pray. Bless in every way, O Lord, the gifts, offerings, and tithes that we give. Enrich our ministries which serve your people, and help us to be grateful to all that we are able to give, knowing that all that we have comes from you. Amen. Oh, we are filled with tensions. We're living in a pandemic, and we can see the light at the end of the tunnel in this, with the vaccinations coming, but oh, that tunnel is so long. And there's violence erupting all over our country, and we don't know what this week is going to bring. But the one thing that we are sure of is that God is with us, that we are not alone, and that God is in control. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make the face to shine upon you, and may the Lord give you peace, both now and in life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you again for being with us this morning on this Martin Luther King Sunday. For our closing song, we sing an anthem of hope, number 339, Lift Every Voice and Sing. Please sing with us verses 1 and 3. Lift Every Voice and Sing.